Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to Main Street in Deadwood. The last time we got together, we talked about the first military expedition to South Dakota. Well, there were other people interested in coming to our state. In fact, believe it or not, another group would be tourists. Now, much like today's tourists, early tourists came to South Dakota for the abundant wildlife, to do nature studies, or to record our state's rich history. But unlike today's tourists, the first tourists didn't have cameras, so they had to write everything down that they saw in journals. In today's South Dakota adventure, we'll thumb through some handwritten manuscripts. In 1811, the famous author and traveler Henry M. Breckinridge came up the Missouri River with Manuel Lisa and his party of fur traders. He kept a careful journal about his experiences. His journal is filled with stories about the area. He was fascinated by seeing prairie dogs for the first time. He called them barking squirrels. Two botanists were on the same trip with Breckinridge, Thomas Nuttall and John Bradbury. In his journal, Breckinridge said that the tough rivermen thought these botanists were crazy, especially Nuttall. He wrote that Nuttall
seems to absorb every thought so as to be troublesome to the company, which has sometimes to wait for him. He appears to have done away with every regard for personal safety. The Fool is the name by which he's commonly known. No sooner does the boat touch the shore than he leaps out, and when his attention is arrested by a plant or a flower, everything else is forgotten.
Mr. Bradbury had done some pretty reckless things while touring the river. He'd forgotten about the seriousness of being on the frontier. But one day, he took a look ahead down the river and realized that the next day's navigation would mostly be taken up with negotiating a pretty good-sized bend in the river. Well, rather than get on the boat the next morning, Bradbury struck out across the neck of the peninsula to meet the boats later in the afternoon. His day was passed pleasantly enough in traversing a beautiful track, making botanical and geological researches, and observing the habits of an extensive village of prairie dogs, at which he'd made several ineffectual shots, without really considering the risk he ran of attracting the attention of any of the savages that might be lurking in the neighborhood. In fact, he had totally forgotten the Sioux Teton and all the other perils of the country when about the middle of the afternoon, as he stood near the riverbank and was looking out for the boats, he suddenly felt a hand laid on his shoulder. Startled, Bradbury turned and saw a half-naked savage with his bow drawn and an arrow pointed at his chest. Bradbury's first reaction was to draw his rifle, then realized the Indian didn't shoot him when he could have, so he lowered his gun and extended his hand in friendship. Bradbury learned the Indian was a Ponca, and together they waited for the boats. In 1832, the famous artist George Catlin visited South Dakota. Catlin was from Philadelphia, and his first contact with the Indians of the West was in 1829, and it convinced him to devote his life to painting the Indians. Even at that early period, Catlin could see that the Indian way of life was passing, and he wanted to record it in his paintings for future generations. Between 1829 and 1838, Catlin painted about 600 paintings of famous Indians and their villages, games, and dances. He also wrote books about the Indian culture. Matlin used to tell a story about painting a Mandan medicine man called Old Bear.
He took his position in the middle of the room, waving his eagle calumets in each hand and singing his medicine song, looking me full in the face until I'd completed his picture. His vanity was completely satisfied by the operation. He lay for hours altogether, day after day, in front of the picture, gazing upon it. Shook my hands a dozen times a day, enlarged upon my medicine virtues and talents, and became my strongest supporter in the community.
The year after Catlin's visit in 1833, Prince Joseph Maximilian came up the river on the steamboat Yellowstone. He later became the King of Bavaria, but at that time he was a scientist, and he made very careful descriptions of the Upper Missouri region, and especially studied rock formations. Maximilian brought Swiss artist Carl Bodmer with him to paint illustrations for the book he was writing. Bodmer painted everything he could about the Indians and their way of life. John C. Fremont, the man known as the Pathfinder for his famous expeditions to the West, came to South Dakota in 1838 with Joseph Nicolet to survey the eastern part of South Dakota. They came westward from Minnesota as far as the James River Valley. They named many lakes in the area, Lake Preston, Lake Ponset, and Lake Albert. They were the first to record accurate details about eastern South Dakota and make a careful map of the area. And Fremont kept a journal and account of his trip.
Now I was to see the buffalo. This was an event on which my imagination had been dwelling. Riding silently up a short slope, we came directly upon the buffalo.
Fremont and Nicolet had a running buffalo hunt, and Fremont got separated from the others. Lost alone on the prairie, he followed the buffalo trails and wandered 15 miles from camp. The others found him the next day. The famous ornithologist John James Audubon came to South Dakota in 1843. Ornithology is a branch of zoology dealing with birds, and Audubon painted beautiful pictures of birds and animals during his visit here. As Audubon and his friends observed new species of birds, they gave them scientific and popular names. The Harris Sparrow is named after Audubon's friend, Edward Harris. Another visitor to come to South Dakota for a different purpose was Father Pierre-Jean de Smit. Born in Belgium, he came to the United States when he was 20 and became one of the leading missionaries to the Indians in North America. From 1839 to 1848, de Smit lived among the Indians of South Dakota and the Pacific Northwest. He was highly respected by the Sioux and was known for being truthful. When the government wanted to negotiate treaties with the Sioux, de Smet was called upon to influence the Sioux people. By 1849, scientists were visiting the Badlands to study the fossils and unusual formations. Scientist John Evans described the Badlands this way.
From the uniform, monotonous open prairie, the traveler suddenly descends 100 or 200 feet into a valley that looks as if it had sunk away from the surrounding world, leaving standing all over it thousands of abrupt, irregular, prismatic, and columnar masses, frequently capped with irregular pyramids and stretching to a height of from 1 or 200 feet or more.
Scientist Thaddeus A. Culbertson arrived in 1850. He too was gathering fossils for study. He said it was very difficult to tell other people what the Badlands looked like. He said,
"Fancy yourself on the hottest day in summer, in the hottest spot of such a place without water, without an animal, and scarce an insect astir, without a single flower to speak pleasant things to you, and you will have some idea of the utter loneliness of the Badlands."
We've talked about the many military expeditions to South Dakota. Scientists came along on these expeditions too. Lieutenant G.K. Warren came with the General Harney expedition in 1855 and stayed through 1857. He sketched many sites in the Dakotas and drew maps of the region. He located the highest point in the Black Hills and named the peak for his commander, Harney. After traveling through the area in western South Dakota, which he found to be dry and desert-like, he was overjoyed when he reached the Black Hills. He wrote,
"The streams which flow into the Cheyenne contain an abundance of fish, and swarms of beaver live along their banks. They are skirted with excellent timber of ash, oak, elm, and box elder. And the level plains are covered with a fine carpet of grass, which in the early spring and summer is enameled with myriads of flowers of the richest hues. On the 9th of March, 1855, I ascended Bear Butte, and on the south side, 600 feet above the level prairie, I found a beautiful plant just putting forth its blossom. The Indians call it the navel flower, for they say when it blooms, young spring is born."
The flower he found was later made South Dakota's state flower, the pasque. These early tourists were as valuable to South Dakota with the written records they kept of our history as today's modern tourists are with the money they spend in our state. Tourism is the second largest industry in South Dakota, and it's probably the second oldest profession, at least here in Deadwood. Tourists come and go, immigrants come and stay. Our next South Dakota adventure takes us to the Dakota Territory border. We'll see you there.